Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies for this morning's meeting. So our first agenda item is to agree to take item 3, which is consideration of today's budget evidence in private. Are we all agreed? That being the case, we move on to our second item on the agenda, which is to continue our budget scrutiny. And I welcome to the meeting Claire Gallagher, Human Rights Officer at the Council of Ethnic Minority Voluntary Sector Organisations Scotland, Dr Alison Hosey, Research Officer, Scottish Human Rights Commission, Professor Angela O'Hagan, Chair, Scottish Government Equalities and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group, and Rob Watts, Economist at the Fraser of Allender Institute. You're all very welcome. Now, as all of our witnesses are virtual today, can I ask them to type R in the chat box if you want to come in on any question as we go through the session. Can I also remind members to direct their questions to a particular witness in the first instance, and then if other witnesses want to come in, they'll type R going through. We don't require every witness to answer and to input into every question. We've got quite a lot of areas that the committee are keen to cover, so hopefully we'll manage to do that in the time available. So I refer members to paper one and now invite each of our witnesses to make some opening remarks, starting with Claire Gallagher, please.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for having me here today. My name is Claire Gallagher and I'm the Human Rights Officer at the Council of Ethnic Minority Voluntary Sector Organisation. We are a national intermediary organisation and a strategic partner of the Scottish Government's Directorate of Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights. The aim of SEMVO is to develop the capacity and sustainability of the sector. And with a network of over 600 organisations, we gather intelligence on issues affecting communities and use that to inform policy and practice. I work within the Race for Human Rights team, and our aim is to embed equality and human rights into the day-to-day functions and strategic planning of public bodies, third sector organisations and private businesses. We adopt an anti-racist and human rights-based approach and offer consultancy support, including policy reviews, trainings, workshops, learning and learning webinars. Thank you.
And if I can now invite Dr. Alison Hosey, please.
Hello, thank you very much for the invitation to join the session today. Budget scrutiny is a key area of my work and a particular strategic focus of the Commission. And I think I'd like to start by saying it's very clear to me in reading a lot of the budget documentation that a lot of effort has gone in this year to producing strong budget documentation and strong supplementary documentation to this year's budget. 4 years ago, when I was asked to give evidence to your predecessor's committee, I was asked about the how much the government was taking a rights-based approach to budgeting, and the very gloomy answer at that point was that they didn't. And while there is still a lot to do, which we'll talk about today, a lot of progress has been made over the last 4 years in this area. And as well as the efforts in producing the supplementary documentation, it's also very clear that a lot of work and time has been invested by the committees, especially your committee, and some areas of government, in trying to get to grips with human rights budget work and to understand and develop the right processes to support this. So a key message for me today coming in is that I want to see parliamentary scrutiny really challenging senior government much more to get on board with this work and to progress it further. And I think for me, the next necessary step on the journey for government is to develop a more grounded understanding of what the content of the rights are that they're trying to achieve. And it's good that budget documentation now points to relevant human rights in portfolio areas, but the next step is really understanding how we respect, protect and fulfil those rights and the budgetary resource necessary to achieve them in practice. So I look forward to exploring that and the challenges in that this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. And if we can now hear from Professor Angela O'Hagan, please.
Good morning, convener. Good morning, colleagues. Thank you very much for the opportunity to talk with the committee this morning. Speaking, I suppose, as the chair of the Equality and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group, I think there's a, following on from what Ali has just said, I do think there are a number of positives to highlight to the committee. The advisory group made a series of recommendations some time ago now to the Scottish Government in relation to the budget process, building knowledge and capacity within Scottish Government to do the type of equality analysis and human rights analysis that will make for better policy making. We're still waiting. The recommendations were well received, but we're still waiting for the responses, which I am assured are to come fairly soon. As Ali has also said, we can see, I think, significant improvements in the multiple documents that are part of the budget suite and that do continue to make us a focus of interest for international and interest from other territories within the UK. However, and I think we can see continuous improvement there. And what we need to be working towards, I think, is a number of things. We need investment in training and capacity building and in time to build the knowledge and build the new ways of thinking and doing if government are going to be better able to fulfil the commitments to meet the recommendations of many advisory groups and parliamentary inquiries. But I think that capacity for scrutiny and that capacity for equality and human rights analysis is something that we all share a need for knowledge and capacity in, and that includes colleagues within the Parliament. I think we need to see greater clarity across the relationship between allocation, spend and outcomes, and greater clarity across the relationship between equality objectives and the realisation of rights, and how policy has been formulated in such a way that that is the starting point for policy thinking and that resource allocations and spend are aligned. And we need to have a better understanding of the outcomes from spend and the implications of changes in spend. And I would also like to draw attention to a number of positives I think there have been, and what has been really quite a challenging year for everybody, and a challenging year for officials within the Scottish Government as well. We have an Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, which continues and has improved the mapping across of human rights. It also has a very extensive annex detailing some of the policy decisions, which represents a huge but underused resource for policymakers and scrutineers like yourselves in Parliament. The fact that there was an equality statement produced at all alongside the equality and budget, the emergency budget review was positive. So despite resourcing pressures, the commitment to integrate that equality analysis into the process was honoured. I think there's potential in the proposed procurement strategy, given the millions of pounds in public money that are allocated in this way, where there should be much more equality and human rights policy making and policy outcomes, and also as an area for scrutiny. The Fiscal Transparency Project, being led by the Scottish Exchequer, is a really interesting project, but hugely beneficial and has huge potential in terms of improving transparency around Scotland's finances. And two things quickly to say about the opportunity presented by the forthcoming Human Rights and Corporation Bill. The National Advisory Council for Women and Girls, which I should declare an interest in, I'm a member of the council, have made a recommendation in relation to ongoing scrutiny, but also made a recommendation that there should be intersectional gender budget analysis on a statutory basis. And the Incorporation Bill, bringing in the Convention and the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women and the International Convention on Economic and Social Rights, gives that opportunity to incorporate intersectional gender budget analysis. And I think that's all I would say. Sorry for taking more than my allocated time there. Thank you.
OK, thanks very much. And if we now have Rob Watts, please.
Hi, everyone. I'm Rob Watts. I'm an economist at the Fraser Valander Institute, which is an economics research institute at Strathclyde University. The budget day is a very busy day for us. We have a keen interest in making sense of the choices that have been made and what these tell us about the government's priorities, so that we can inform the public debate about the trade-offs and choices that we face as a society, both in Scotland and across the UK. But I think the reason I've been invited here today is because last summer I undertook an academic fellowship with SPICE, aiming to further the committee's understanding of human rights budgeting and how it could be applied in a Scottish context. And it was a learning journey for me as well. One of my key takeaways was that we often think about human rights in terms of political and civil rights, like freedom of speech, right to private life, and these place obligations on governments to refrain from acting. But with a new human rights bill on the horizon, enshrining economic, social and cultural rights into Scots law for the first time, these would place obligations on governments to take active steps to progressively realise rights over time and deliver on a minimum core element of each right immediately for everyone within their jurisdiction. So the choices that governments make over how to raise, allocate and spend resources is critical in meeting its obligations, and we need to think about budgets in terms of its human right, terms of their human rights impact. So I would echo what Dr. Ali Hosey and Professor Angela O'Hagan just said. Progress has certainly been made in linking the budget to human rights. So I'm very grateful to be here to explore where we are, where this goes next, and yeah, looking forward to this discussion.
That's great. Thanks very much to everyone. So we'll now move to questions. So I want to start with an area that came up in our pre-budget scrutiny. A number of our witnesses in pre-budget scrutiny said that some of the documentation wasn't accessible to everyone. So just to ask whether the panel think that the documents published this year meet the aspirations of documentation being accessible, and maybe if there's areas where accessibility wasn't as good as it can be, what they were, and if there's any suggestions about how we can improve that. So I think it's probably one that most people might want to come into, but maybe kicking off with Claire.
Thank you. In terms of accessibility, I think there was great progress made in this year's budget, and there are always ways to learn, and we're very early on in this journey in Scotland of human rights budgeting. Coming from not a finance background, I found the Your Scotland, Your Finance portal and document really, really useful and very clear. I would say that it would just maybe about why decisions were made, and that it should always be published at the same time as the budget, because that was really integral for my understanding of the budget. In terms of the budget in itself and accessibility, there are still a lot of acronyms and economic jargon, which is to be expected within a budget. I think we could progress a little bit further to put more acronyms easily available on that. And I think we need to remember, I remember at the pre-budget scrutiny giving evidence, and we talked a lot about accessibility and targeted engagement and what that would look like. I think we still need to do a little bit more in terms of capacity building about the budget process. What is the budget? Why is it important to me? And really targeting those priority groups in society that are not engaged within the process, and talking to them about why budget decisions matter to them. Is it for council tax, your children's education? I think that is really vital. And I think that's all I'll say on that just now. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And you never need to apologise for a pet coming on screen, particularly if it's a cat. So thanks for that. Angela, would you like to make a few words on that kind of general area about accessibility? Or
sure. Again, I mean, to echo colleagues, and that there has been significant improvement, I think. The improvements are mainly in the annexes and the multiple documents around the main budget document. And the main budget document still remains a bit of an art form, really, to try and work your way through the budget document, which goes to Claire's point about public information and how well informed are the public, which takes us into other areas around transparency and other areas of participation. So I think there is still a job to do, certainly if you're trying to follow the money across the budget, and how expressions of allocations are presented make that very difficult. There is an ongoing lack of clarity there. Multiple repetitions of allocations, but it's not clear from which budget line they're coming.
the narrative not always aligning with what's in the different tables, etc. And in the annexes, I'm thinking just now of the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, where there are some very helpful selected examples of the types of policies that are being, where money is being spent. But there needs to be greater clarity on how those examples have been selected and explain the purpose of those examples. And without having to delve into what can appear to be quite a daunting annex, a very valuable resource though it is. I think further in terms of accessibility and understanding the budget itself and what different allocations mean, is a need to reintroduce what I think used to be there, or it used to be somewhere in some of the documentation, a clearer indication of where spend is up and down, up or down. And as colleagues, particularly from Audit Scotland, have repeatedly emphasised at EBAG, the importance of understanding the implications of decisions, particularly where the decision has been to reduce the amount of spend, and how have the implications and potential impacts of those decisions considered, and for that to be more clearly articulated and presented. And finally, and I don't want to cut across Ali, but I think in terms of accessibility, there's really good stuff in the annexes in terms of the use of graphics and colours and so on. But there needs to be, I think, greater mapping across of the individual rights onto different portfolios and greater clarity as to what that means. But I'll let others come in.
Okay, thanks for that. And if we can go to Ali now, please.
I think my views on the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, the data is in the annexes, but you have to go and delve around to find a lot of the information that you want. And so I was a bit disappointed with the statement itself. I felt like coming away from it not really knowing what evidence had informed the decisions or what difference any evidence had made to the budgetary decisions. There was not sufficient clarity around the decision-making process regarding funding and the impact of these decisions or the data that underpinned them. And so the content, to a degree, it felt a little bit elementary. So while I completely understand the need for accessibility and clarity of presentation, which was very welcome, the very elementary nature of the presentation of the information gave rise to a wee bit of concern that what sits behind it is an elementary understanding. And that's where Angela was talking there about the connection between, you know, the content of the rights and what's actually trying to be achieved. I'm not sure the level of understanding is there on that aspect. So there are a number of vague statements connecting budget to impact or positive potential impact on people's rights, but there was no substance to explain how that was to be achieved. So a little bit more detail, a few more lines around the illustrative examples that they have around the type of spending. So, you know, the analysis that went into formulating those policy actions, because otherwise, at the moment, when you read through, you're left wondering, you know, why these examples, have they been cherry picked? What was the reasoning behind there? And that leads on to sort of transparency issues that I'm sure we'll come back to later on. But just on the issue of the Your Scotland, Your Finance guide, I thought that was a really good accessible document. It introduces the citizen to what the budget is about, why spending is needed, where it is needed, where money comes from. And a citizen's budget should be a sort of gateway to information. They're not meant to replace the detailed budget documents, but they are important for introducing citizens and civil society to the knowledge that they need to participate as informed stakeholders to be able to hold government to account for its spending decisions. But I think there's an important distinction to be addressed here around the question of what we want a citizen's style budget document to do, because there can be more than one type of citizen's document produced at different points in the budget cycle and supporting different aspects of the budget process. So should we be producing a pre-budget statement that supports boosting participation and engagement before decisions are made? Or is it just about raising awareness and providing information after the decisions are made? And that is necessary, and that is what this document does. It's not a bad thing, but the more of these kind of tools that there are, the more we can support participation of people to engage on decisions before they're actually made. And I think that reinforces points that Claire made earlier as well around education and the need for education. I think the government's been a bit too passive, possibly the Parliament as well, in just producing documents without actively promoting them. And I think that we need to support people to engage in this. The budget's not for everybody, but it should be for everybody. And we need to help support public education to make this something that people want to get involved with. I'll leave it there. Thank you.
OK, thank you. And go to Rob, please.
Yeah, thanks. So, firstly, I just want to stress the importance of accessibility. It underpins all of the three principles that go into a human rights budget process: transparency, participation, and accountability. So they can't happen if citizens are not engaged and able to understand the budget decisions that have been made that affect their lives. So it's very important. And I would say, as an economist, as someone who's worked as part of a team of economists, sometimes it takes us a bit of time to get our head around the main budget document and to make sense of the decisions that have been made. But that might just be a reflection of the fact that it is a very complex and big process to go through. So it is welcome that budget information is conveyed in different formats. One opportunity for further progress around accessibility might be around producing budget documents in a greater variety of formats. So, for example, in my SPICE briefing last year, I based it on a case study of people with learning disabilities. Often people with learning disabilities use easy read documents to process information. So it'd be useful to have an easy read document, for example, published alongside the budget. But there are other formats as well, like a British Sign Language version, for example, or perhaps even in different languages. So yeah, there are some opportunities for further improvement.
Thank you. And we go to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to our panel. Thanks again for joining us, and also for the evidence that you've submitted to the budget process and to our committee. I just want to ask a couple of questions around accessibility, and maybe to start with yourself, Rob. The Scottish Government have said in the response to our letter that they've worked hard to make at least the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, and they've called it deliberately accessible. Can you see that in there, and is that enough?
So yes, it is more accessible. And setting out each portfolio, the clear link to the national outcomes and human rights at the start is quite a way of presenting information that I think everybody can understand. It was a very long document, and a lot of the narrative in the document could perhaps point to more detailed examples of the impact of spending decisions and the data that backs that up. And as for whether it's sufficient, I guess that's a judgment that can be made. There's the Open Budget Survey, which has a set of objective measures that can score the budget against in line with human rights budgeting process. And this was last done in Scotland before a number of recent changes were made. So it might be something to consider to kind of revisit this survey and assess what's happening now in the budget against these metrics.
Ali, next.
I have a further question in that area. Sorry.
Sorry. Okay. Okay, do you want to go first before?
Oh, sorry, I thought you went on to that. Yep, no problem. Sorry.
Sorry, yeah. Okay, so Ali, and then, I mean, unless you want to add that into the mix so that folk are.
No, it's okay.
Okay, Ali, and then Claire.
Hi, it was just a quick note to say that since my last discussion with Rob on this topic, we at the Commission, we've decided to repeat the Open Budget Survey process. The research is underway at the moment, and we will be publishing the results along with the global survey results in spring next year. So we did this process in 2019, and we found that processes were lacking in a number of areas, and we provided information on where we saw improvement was needed. And it'll be very interesting, as Rob said, to see where or how much progress has been made benchmarked against international best practice. Thanks.
Okay, thanks. And then Claire, and then back to Pam DG.
Hi, thank you. Just finally on the accessibility, and it kind of just echoes what Rob was saying before. I think the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement is very thorough, It is detailed and thorough. I think in terms of accessibility, it still has a lot of room to improve. When I read it, it is very clear, but when I'm thinking of other people reading it, it isn't. It's a lot of words on one page, and you scroll down it, it isn't an easy read. And there are also, mention again what Rob had said, there aren't other versions of the document in other languages. And I think that is absolutely paramount in all these items that are required for people to empower people to learn about the budget process and the impact that the budget is having on priority areas and protected characteristic groups. These need to be published at the same time, and there are standards out there in terms of what easy reads, what does that mean and what does that look like. There are national standards out there for that. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. And Pam?
Thank you, and sorry, Convener, for interrupting. I'd assume we were moving on to another question wrongly, so thank you for setting me straight. I have a further question in this area, and it's to Angela O'Hagan, if that's okay. Good morning. I noticed that in your submissions you've said in the past that capacity and support for organisations to engage in the Fairer Scotland, Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement is crucial, and we know that that's important to both accessibility and transparency. What capacity and support do you think is required? Is it there? And what could be done to further improve that?
Thanks very much. Good morning. It's nice to see you. I think, as I have said many times to iterations of this committee and across government, both the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government could do very much more to raise public awareness of Scotland's finances. The Your Scotland, Your Rights is a great example. It's a really good example of an accessible, easily understandable piece of public information. But there needs to be much more work on basic information and public information to make any efforts, any approaches to and opportunities for participation more meaningful. So I think I don't disagree with what colleagues are saying, but the two need to go hand in hand. Producing the budget documentation in multiple formats and multiple versions, people need to know that it's there, and they need to know, have some background to what the information, what that information is and how they can use it, rather than just produce it and expect it to have that effect. So I think from both the government and parliament, there needs to be greater effort, and that means some spending around meaningful opportunities to participate and to achieve those, or to make those opportunities meaningful. There needs to be much more effort in engaging people, in building their knowledge, building their capacity, understanding the structure of Scotland's finances, the budget processes, what the government does and what Parliament does, what the whole raft of public organisations do. Because I think, again, you know, we need to remember, as scrutineers, as advisers and as members of the public, that the Scottish budget is largely dispersed to a whole range of other organisations who then spend that money according to their plans or their agreements with government. And that relationship needs to be much more closely scrutinised, but also much better understood publicly as to where the distinctions are between what government does and what a whole set of other agencies do. So I think creating and resourcing participation and knowledge building would increase public capacity for engaging in better quality and more meaningful outcomes from consultation and participation. And it would also perhaps shift the practice a little bit and maybe avoid repeatedly asking the same questions of some of the same community and public sector organisations. And I've again spoken to this committee and others about the committees themselves being much more engaged with community organisations to build that capacity, build that knowledge around public finances, around scrutinising finances, and that in itself, that information from the lived experience of trying to navigate or trying to understand public information would then inform the presentation of content and the different versions of that content in future iterations of the budget and other policy documents.
Okay, thank you. Can I go to Rachel Hamilton, please?
you. The Fraser of Allender Institute states that there is little evidence of robust analysis of how Scottish budget decisions will enable human rights to be realised. So can I start with Angela O'Hagan and ask what research and analysis has the Scottish Government conducted on how the budget will enable human rights to be realised?
It's a very big question because there's lots of different facets to it. I can answer it from the perspective of the Equality and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group, which is to say that we have now we have a work plan which cuts across a range of public policy areas. We don't have a policy-making role and we don't have a role in commissioning research, but because we don't have a budget either. But we have had a significant input on, for example, the distributional analysis that is produced within government, the shape and content of the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, and a constant improvement programme really around how equality and human rights analysis are integrated into the policy making process across government. And that is involved, or that comprises as well, trying to influence and inform and shape the review of the public sector equality duty. Lots of recommendations and suggestions on improvement of the equality and human rights impact assessment process. And as I've just said in a number of my answers around the need to build knowledge and capacity, there's been significant improvements in the equality through the equality data improvement plans. The next steps, I think, are not only do we need good and better intersectional data, we need a better understanding of what that data tells policymakers and members of the public and members of the Parliament, and a better understanding of how to use that data in policy making and in scrutinising policy decisions, outcomes and spending decisions. So there's a whole range of work goes on across the social research within Scottish Government. We saw some very useful and important research come out alongside the budget in relation to the cost of living crisis. There is the in-depth analysis that forms the annex to the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement. But what we don't see are those resources being well used, either within Parliament or within government or externally. And they are significant resources that can and should be used to inform policy making. So in terms of what research, there's a whole raft of research. What we try to do through EBAG is to draw on experiences across and expertise across the members, but also to look across other territories of the United Kingdom and internationally. And we had an international comparative practice session just a couple of months ago, looking at what the OECD would recommend and trying to benchmark where the next steps are for the Scottish budget process in relation to the OECD findings across many, many countries around the world. And we look closely to see what's happening in Wales and in the Republic of Ireland, and through a range of civil society organisations, draw on practices that are emerging in Wales, Northern Ireland, the Republic, the UK Women's Budget Group, the Tax Justice Network, and so on. So there's a lot of informal research-based evidence coming into the deliberations in EBAG, which then go on to inform some of the improvements that we've seen in the budget documentation.
Yeah, thank you.
Want to come in,
can I just come back to Angela O'Hagan before I bring the others in?
Well, okay, but briefly, because I'll have to have...
Thank you. I just wanted some clarification when you opened, and thank you for your answer. You said you had no budget. What did that mean?
Exactly as I say, it's an advisory group. It doesn't have a programme budget. But we draw significantly on the resources of the members who are external members and draw significantly on the time of Scottish Government officials, both in servicing and meeting with the advisory group and in then conducting and actioning the recommendations from the advisory group.
Pam DG wants to come in very briefly on this point, I think, and then I've got Ali and Rob both wanting to come in on the wider issue. But
Yeah, thank you. It was just to ask, are you aware of resources in the budget that go to other organisations to support some of the capacity building that you, that, in response to my earlier question and following from Rachel Hamilton's question?
I mean, specifically resources that go to other organisations to boost capacity and understanding around the budget process?
Yeah.
Not that I'm aware of. Well, Scottish Women's Budget Group is sorry, the most obvious one that would come to my mind. And they have received a grant. Again, I should declare I'm a trustee of the Scottish Women's Budget Group, but have no had no role in that application. But the Scottish Women's Budget Group have a programme of capacity building on gender budgeting with local governments. And so that's one, I think possibly the only, but I don't know. I don't know across the whole how that budget is dispersed across the whole of Scottish voluntary sector and third sector. In relation specifically to building capacity in the budget process is obviously something that I think should be much better funded than it is and should be an integral part of our civic understanding.
Thanks.
Go to Ali and then Rob, please.
Thanks. Just in relation to the sort of clarity around decision making, that moving on from what Angela said, you know, we are still asking frequently for more transparent information around the decision-making process to understand how all of that research that Angela highlighted is used to inform decisions. In some of the pre-budget scrutiny on the decisions of the resource spending review, for example, we argued that we couldn't come to any conclusions about whether the right areas had been focused on because we couldn't access the evidence around the decision-making process that had taken place. So there was no visibility of the impact assessments about how the decisions had been reached. And this is not new. This is, you know, something that's been argued since committees started doing scrutiny. That there needs to be a better showing of the government's working in the margins. How are decisions made? And leaving aside the political aspect of the negotiations that happen around budgetary decisions each year, what we have consistently argued for is to see a better rationale and justification of spending decisions that are informed by human rights standards and equalities data. We are seeing improvements, but we're still not there. And what we also continue to argue for is a much better relationship between the commitments in annual budgets and the monitoring and measurement of outcomes of those budgets year on year and cumulatively. And this is where I feel that the parliamentary committees could be stronger in challenging the government by saying, you know, this is what you said you were going to do. What have you done and what have the outcomes been of your spend? And the clearer the budget commitments are and the links to the main policy drivers or the frameworks underpin them and what outcomes they're anticipating or aiming to achieve, and how they intend to evaluate that impact, the easier it will be for us to have that desired clarity over the decision making. So the other areas we've frequently commented here is around seeing much better links to the relationships between budgets, the programme for government, the national performance framework, outcome and indicators. And I know that's something we're likely to come on to later, so I'll hold my thoughts on that bit for now. Thank you.
Thanks. And Rob?
Yeah, so if we're talking about the data and research that underpins decision making and the impacts of budget decisions on human rights, the key document here is the Equalities and Fairer Scotland statement, and you can see the progress that's been made, you know, directly or explicitly linking the human rights to each portfolio. Within each portfolio, there is commentary around new spend, the expected impact, and links to research. But I think the next steps are some of the information is quite generalised. Some of the rights that are allocated to each portfolio actually cut across many more portfolios than are sometimes attributed to. And you know, some of the research and evidence that's pointed out actually doesn't link to the protected characteristic that it's highlighted under. So, yeah, I guess just a bit more clarity and detail would be the next steps. And the other thing is, budgets are trade-offs, and as users, we want to understand not just this X million pounds is spent on this and this is the expected impact, but we also want to understand, well, if we're spending it on that, why are we not spending it on this? And what's the balance of trade-off that have been struck? And why is this a priority and not that a priority? And then how that links to human rights. And that's the kind of commentary that would be useful to have in the equality statement.
Okay, thank you. Can I go to Maggie Chapman, please?
Thanks very much, Joe. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning and for your comments so far. I want to delve into a little bit more detail on questions of accountability. Angela, you said in your opening remarks that the clear need for much stronger or deeper scrutiny of Scottish Government decision-making. And Ali, just in your previous answer there, you were talking about the linkages across to Programme for Government, National Performance Framework and other sort of policy frameworks, and how these assist or otherwise our understanding of realisation of rights. Could you comment on, and I'll start with Ali, if I can, could you comment on those linkages to the MPF and the Programme for Government, do they actually aid our understanding in what outcomes, what human rights outcomes we're seeking to achieve? And if not, what could we be doing differently?
I mean, on a positive note, we are hearing, as Angela and Rob have also been hearing, more progress towards better linkages in the National Performance Framework and national outcomes and budgets. And in the budget documents, as Rob said, the portfolios all indicate the associated national outcomes and relevant human rights. But it doesn't go any deeper than that. And that's where I think that the improvement is needed. That there's no obvious depth to the understanding of those connections. And there's no understanding of what the content of the specific rights are in terms of what they're meant to be achieving. So I talked a lot about this in my pre-budget evidence with regards to the resource spending review as well. And the points are very similar here. That although there is a narrative on the MPF and the national outcomes presented within the statement, it doesn't explore the prioritisation of resources through the lens of Scotland's national outcomes. There are no direct connections made between allocated spend and national outcomes. There's not a budget line. Therefore, the way that both the MPF and all of the budget documents are constructed limits accountability because they don't allow for a transparent assessment of impact. So from a rights perspective, these outcomes should be grounded in Scotland's international human rights obligations and commitments. It's something I've argued for a long time, that the whole of the MPF could be grounded in our international obligations, but it is not presented in that way just now. And in terms of stemming from an assessment of an analysis of human rights concerns facing different groups across different sectors, such as housing and health and education, the broad framing of the National Performance Framework, it needs to be more closely aligned to spending commitments and annual budgets, scrutiny of outcomes and the human rights obligations under international law. So the government's policies would then be designed to respond to those concerns, and an assessment would need to be made to ascertain the level of resource required to deliver on those policies. And then the government would be further required to explore how to generate the necessary funds. Following that allocation, the government would then monitor how the money was spent. Was it spent as it was planned to? If not, how was it redistributed? What was it delivered to whom? You know, and evaluate whether the policy was implemented and planned and what impact that had. But if we're saying that the national outcomes are the key concerns for Scotland, then the priorities and the annual programme for government and the budget need to be aligned with them. Starting with the outcomes we're trying to achieve, assessing what is required in terms of policy, and then resource to achieve those outcomes, and then exploring what resource generation is required to fund that. So in scrutinising outcomes, this is where parliamentary scrutiny could be improved as well. Not in a party political way, but actually trying to follow the money, as Angela said earlier, and to follow what we've agreed the outcomes will be, and are those outcomes being achieved? And if not, how are policy interventions being rethought? What implications there are for that? So. I suppose the other thing about implications of changing spending decisions, which Angela referred to before as well, is what happens when we take money away from an area, not just impact assessing when something is to be allocated. So those are all areas that I think could be improved. Thanks.
Thanks, Ali. That's really clear. And the suggestions for how we rethink the national performance framework, I think, are really helpful. Angela, could I bring you in and ask for your comments on that, and also if there are particular sort of cross-portfolio issues or inconsistencies or conflicts potentially that you see that we need to be teasing out, particularly if we're thinking about human rights in the round and an outcome or impact focus rather than departmental silos?
Sure. I'm not sure that there's much to add to Ali's fantastic human rights budget scrutiny 101 there. It was really superb and comprehensive answer. I would want to maybe re-emphasise, as Ali has done, the alignment with the National Performance Framework. You know, the NPF is this long-term vision of what we want to realise as a nation and with our resources. And we, of course, need to secure the maximisation of those resources, which has significant implications, obviously, for revenue raising and how public money is raised. And I think there's often too little attention paid to that, yet it's also been an area where, in terms of transparency and accessibility and participation, there have been quite a lot. There's been quite a lot of activity in recent months. Anyway, that's a side point. So greater alignment with the NPF, as Ali says, you know, National Performance Framework is long term, needs to be supported by multi-annual budgeting, updated by the annual programme for government, and an annual budget statement and adjustments to the budget, which should clearly map onto one another and therefore make much more clear what it is that government intends to do, what resources are being allocated, how outcomes are understood, and are those outcomes achieving the intended objectives, and if not, how they should be reoriented. Now, Rob, being an economist, talks about trade-offs. I don't talk about trade-offs because I think we should start always from the perspective of advancing equality and securing the realisation of rights. However, I understand the broader point that public resources are tight, and that's been clearly set out in the resource spending review and the subsequent emergency budget review, and obviously in the current draft budget. But you asked there about specific areas, and I think it's very clear that we can see the hollowing out of local government finance that has happened consistently in recent years, that reduction in its resource base, making it increasingly difficult to provide basic statutory services. Education services are about to take a really big hit, yet attainment and the attainment gap is a priority government mission, and child poverty is the mission of government. Social care is chronically underfunded, and the economic multiplier benefits of investing in care and the care economy are consistently underplayed or even disregarded in economic policy. And cuts to funding across public services have a knock-on effect across all sorts of policy areas. And in my home city of Glasgow, we're seeing a proposal to cut the funding to food train. Now, social isolation, the importance of living well and preventing deterioration in health and independent living amongst older people are priorities within government policy. And yet, and we know from research for the University of Glasgow for Food Train that more older people in receipt of local authority care provision are malnourished. And that's a consequence of the statutory time limitations on care packages and also staff shortages to meet those requirements. And yet, the food chain in Glasgow faces closure of lifeline food provision and social services due to council decisions. So, funding is tight, yes, but decisions need to be made from a different perspective that starts with securing the minimum rights without discrimination, and then building the kinds of services and approaches to allocation to come back round that deliver the vision that's set out within the NPF.
Thanks very much, Angela. I know Claire wants to come in, and then I will bring Robin.
Thank you very much. I'd just like to come back on to your original point about accountability. And I think there was a broader question within the budget about where accountability lies. So we know that accountability is one of the three core principles of human rights budgeting, but we also know when we read the budget that money gets allocated to a certain amount of public bodies straight away, and that is the process. So we then have the Equality Act to make sure that these public bodies are compliant with their public sector equality duties. But we know, and we hear time and time again, that the public sector equality duties and mainstreaming reports have largely become a tick box exercise and aren't having much impact anymore. If ever, they've never not realised their potential. So I think we have to think about where the accountability lies. If X amount of money is given to a public body, but we can see through their public sector equality duties and their mainstreaming reports that they're really not meeting their targets in terms of improving race equality, disability, gender pay gap, they're not reaching those targets. What are we then saying to them to be accountable? Is it within the budget that you say X amount of money to that public body must be contingent on improvement in that area? Or is that the relationship between the government and the public body? But it wherever that lies, that conversation lies, that needs to be clear and transparent, and it's not at the moment. And I think we need to remember that if a public body is continuously not achieving the public sector equality duties, where do we draw the line? Improvement plans are required and necessary, but we're talking about some public bodies provide vital support and realising people's human rights. So where do we draw the line? And I know that you need to improve, but while you're improving, you're still missing and not providing services for a certain part of society. And I think that also kind of, to me, it all links in with funding towards the third sector, because I think, if I remember correctly, the funding has been decreased this year for third sector, but we know that a lot of public bodies rely on third sector for the expertise, their knowledge, and helping them with their mainstreaming report, with helping them to improve their gender pay gap or their race equality or improve their anti-racism practices. So if we're decreasing that support, where is it coming from? And finally, I think a lot of this can be a step forward, could improve through transparency. And that one of the things that I noted that would help this would be why decisions were made. And we've talked about that a lot within the budget process so far. So if X amount of money is given to the development of an action plan on racism within health and social care, the reason is because we know that there's a direct link between institutional racism and the outcomes that it has on people's access to services and positive outcomes on health and social care services. So I think we just need to improve that gap there, and also the impact assessments as well, that mentioned before, but the impact assessments are very thorough and each protected characteristic, but I think we need to be more strategic with them. So the impact assessments, a huge part of an impact assessment is we've identified a disproportionate impact on this protected characteristic group or marginalised group, but there wasn't the next step that's required in an impact assessment. What are we doing to alleviate that or to help that group realise their rights, because we know it's going to have a disproportionate impact? And that was missing throughout all portfolios. And I think as well, we always, at Symbol Scotland, we always advocate and support that those carrying out impact assessments should be trained continuously on equalities and on protected characteristics and what they are. There was a few discrepancies between some nationalities were put under religion, and I think we just need to get the system streamlined a wee bit more and be a wee bit more strategic and make sure that there is a consistency across all portfolios. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Claire. That's helpful, and those suggestions or your comments around we go so far and we miss the next steps. I think that those points are well made. Rob, can I bring you in if you've got any comments on this? And I'm aware of time, so I'll leave it there after this.
A few other members want to come in as well.
Right. Okay.
So just quickly on this point around silos, a good illustration of this is Social Security, I think. Because the choices the Scottish Government have made on social security, you can absolutely see it through a human rights lens. And if you look at it in isolation, it could be seen as evidence of progressive realisation of human rights. But the problem is that these policies are expensive, and there is a growing gap between the cost of these commitments and the funding received from social security block grants. And by 2027-28, that's forecast to grow to £1.4 billion. So the obvious question is, how is this going to be funded? And there might be a danger that it's funded by moving resources that would otherwise enable human rights in other areas of public service delivery, for example. That's the danger of looking at things in silos. At least starting a conversation and trying to understand how that's going to be managed and see through government decision making on that is quite essential, I think.
Thanks, Rob. And I think that links to the work that we're going to be doing on minimum core and actually getting that baseline across all those connections. But I'll leave it there for now. Thanks, Joe.
Still got a number of members wanting to come in this area. So first of all, Karen Adam.
Convener, and thank you to the panel this morning. It's been really informative. I think it was Angela was speaking about making budgeting more accessible to people, and you made it more accessible to me this morning, so I appreciate that. It's been really helpful. I found it quite interesting how we're talking about the outcomes, flipping that and tracing the money from the outcomes backwards, and how we can do that in a more meaningful, progressive way. I was just wondering, in my previous life, I used to be a local councillor, and the public sector equality duty was always at the back of the papers, and whether that was seen, last or first, or how that was used, it was often a bit of a symbol to myself as, and asking, was this an afterthought? And we do have a lot of tools, but are they being used in the right way and used at the right time when it comes to making these decisions? And I'm just wondering if you feel there are any missed opportunities in regards to the Scottish Government's approach that you believe would be more measurable in terms of outcomes. We spoke about outcomes coming first. How do we measure those outcomes? Have there been any missed opportunities? There seems to be a lot of cart before horse a lot of the time. So if you personally could tidy things up a bit, what opportunities do you feel are there, and what would you be your preferred system for that? Can I start with Alison, please?
If I could develop my ideal system, I would flip the way that we budget on its head. We start with, Angela will like this when I talk about pie, we start with our budget pie, and we guss about priorities and who's going to get what slice of this pie. But we don't start from, is the pie as big as it could be? And what I think we should be looking at is what is it we are trying to achieve? So this is within the national outcomes through our programme for government. What is it we're trying to achieve? How do we believe we need, or what policies do we need to achieve that, or laws? What funding do we need to realise those policies in practice, and how are we going to raise the resources that we need? And I know we've been discussing around resource constraints, but one of the key obligations of the human rights budgeting is that you maximise your available resources. And whilst I was really pleased that the Scottish Government did dip their toe into the whole issue around taxation, and we were starting to look at more progressive taxation, I do think that they missed, maybe in terms of their focus, they didn't explore what they could have in relation to council tax reform or a local-based wealth tax. I know that that is within the government's existing tax powers. So I suppose I would recommend exploring the research done by Landman Economics, published in December, where they fully explored and costed out realistic and progressive options with regards to taxation that would allow Scotland to fund investment in our public services, including real-term increases in pays for public sector workers. The reforms that they recommended within the initial years could raise up to £1.3 billion in revenue, and over a longer period, over a parliamentary term, potentially up to just over £3 billion. So there are some real opportunities there about how we actually maximise our resources to start with, rather than starting from a limited pot. But I do think that we need to look at what we want to prioritise. When we all talk about what kind of Scotland do we want to live in, what do we want our budget service? What are our priorities? And start from there. That's how I would work backwards then to what you need, and then working out what you need. I'll leave it there.
Of course, the issue there is the priorities become the the push and pull of politics often, and it's trying to get that.
True, but I suppose that's where human rights obligations are key, because they're not something nice to do. Mm. They're legal obligations. And whilst we haven't incorporated yet, we have signed up to these various treaties through the United Kingdom. And what the incorporation in Scotland will do will reaffirm our existing commitments. We already have these obligations. And so the legal obligations are there irrespective of who's in power. And I know that it doesn't always appear apolitical, but these are legal obligations. And looking at it from that perspective takes a little of the politics out of it.
That's really helpful. Thank you. Can
I think that Claire and Rob would like to come in. So, I don't know. So Claire.
Thanks.
Thank you. Yeah, I would just like to pick up on the point that you've made, Karen, about public sector equality duties, and they sometimes seem like an afterthought, and definitely through our work at SEMVO, that is what we come across. They're not sought through in a strategic sense. It should be at the beginning of the process and continuous throughout the process, and not something that's done at the end of your decision making or service design or whatever. It should be at the start of it. And I think also about what our priorities are. Our data that we collect can tell you a lot. It is our evidence for everything, but we know that we struggle to collect meaningful data in Scotland because of barriers that people face to disclosing their information. And I think there is, I talked about this before, about how we can improve the collection of data. But I'd like to focus on a little bit about disaggregating the data. So I think we need to be disaggregating the data a little bit better, because that tells us what's really going on. If we don't do that, we don't know what's going on. And that starts with, what are we asking in the first place? We need to ensure that service providers, local authorities, public bodies are asking the same questions. Public bodies and local authorities will ask you different questions. So maybe in the race bracket, they might have white British, white Scottish, and other in one local authority, and then in another one they'll have a full list of other ethnicities. So I think we need to have a much more streamlined and strategic approach to that, because if we're not asking the same questions, then we're never going to know what's going on, and we can never capture that intersectionality that we know is really important. And I think also as well about, there's something in there about the tools that we have. So we know we've got impact assessments, and that's a really good tool. And as I said before, we need the next step. But we also need to know how much money is going into each sector. So if our data, and if we get our data right, is telling us that we really need to put more money into the realisation of certain rights for persons with disabilities, or to challenge institutional racism, perhaps hate crime is on the rise. So that's our priority, and that is our evidence, and we'd be transparent and say that. But it needs to be, it comes back to this kind of term of meaningful allocation. So I think within future Equality and Fairer Scotland statements, it would be really beneficial to have that trace of, here is our information, this is why disability or race is getting more money. We're giving Equality and the Human Rights and Inclusion Directorate £8 million, but £3 million of that is going straight towards this area. And it sounds quite simplistic, but I think it's a good way to start. But we have to start. I did appreciate it was noted quite a lot throughout the budget process about improving data processes in Scotland. Thanks.
Thanks. I know Rob's wanting to come in, but we also have Pam, DG, I think, and Rachel wanting to come in as well. So I wonder if Pam, do you want to go first and maybe just let Rob come in early on? So if Pam, have you bringing your...
Yeah. Thank you. It was just further on the points about human rights, and also if it's okay to ask at this point as well around the third sector. I'm just keen to know, Do witnesses agree with Audit Scotland about the implementation gap when it comes to human rights and what we say or what the government says in its policy intentions around the budget? And also, can you outline any areas where you feel that this year's budget process has failed to meet commitments by the government on accessibility, transparency and participation in relation to the delivery of human rights?
Can we start with Rob? I think just because I know Rob's maybe want to cover some of the other points.
Thanks, yeah. So just briefly on a previous point about outcomes. Ali mentioned that, you know, these are not nice to have. They're essential obligations that are placed on the government, especially if they're, once the Human Rights Bill is incorporated. And I think it's a valid question to ask government. You know, how are they assured that the government has met its obligations, and how do they know, what comfort do they have that the budget enables them to meet their human rights obligations, and what evidence and outcomes are they basing that on? There's also a big other piece of work around minimum core obligations, which I think may be safe for another day. But this point about it, it should be cross-party. It should be able to withstand a change of government. And yeah, kind of take the politics out of it. And as for the point on third sector, I would probably leave that to others, witnesses who might have more to say than me.
Okay. Pam, were you wanting someone else to come in?
It would be helpful perhaps to if Angela could maybe comment as well, and also just in relation to specifically, Angela, if you could, comments that the Scottish Women's Convention made about women being overlooked largely when it came to that part of the process.
I think I would agree there is an implementation gap, and it goes to the point Sally made earlier on. There is a knowledge gap across government, across public sector, and across the community and third sector in relation to human rights and what human rights means, that it's a contested idea, that it's also an enabling framework in terms of service design, and that, as colleagues have said repeatedly, that it's a set of legal obligations which are about to be reinforced through the Incorporation Bill. And I think there's a need for immediate attention to be paid and capacity developed within all of these organisations, and for it not to be seen as a burden, as an encumbrance upon public services by, you know, whoever they're delivered by, but rather it is a necessity, not just a legal compliance, but it is a necessity to take a human rights-based approach in order to secure, you know, the realisation of rights. We talk about a well-being economy, we talk about all sorts of things about improving people's well-being, but we actually need to, as Karen has pointed up, to better use some of those analytical tools and to build the analytical capacity in applying the evidence from that, to have a clearer understanding of what the so-called problem is, why actions are necessary and what actions are appropriate. So making better use of the tools, not just for legal compliance, but because they make for better policy. I'm not quite sure, Pam, what the point is you're referring to in terms of women being overlooked. I think there is I would certainly have a generalised concern and have made this point many times, that taking an equalities mainstreaming approach does risk gendered experiences being subsumed within that more generalised approach, just as an equalities mainstreaming approach may fail to understand or properly identify and be able to act on people with disability, the experience of people with disabilities, etc. And I think the risk that, I mean, is it a fine balance, or is it about better understanding structural discrimination? Taking a protected characteristics approach risks individualising and increasing silos and individualising concepts of discrimination. Intersectionality, how well is that understood? And we're seeing lots of language, gender competence, intersectionality being used a great deal more. But as Ali said earlier on, what's the understanding behind some of that language? And it's building that understanding that I think we need to see some resourcing and time spent around improving knowledge and practice. And that means understanding the discriminatory effects of race discrimination, disability discrimination, and the intersections and overlapping experiences of, for example, disabled women or low-income women. But disabled women are very often low-income women, just as lone parents, particularly women, 92% of lone parents are low-income. So it's understanding those intersections and the causes of them, and that they are structural and very often reinforced by policy decisions that don't take cognizance of, that aren't informed by Equalities data and by an intention from the outset to secure the progressive realisation of rights. I'm not sure if I have answered your question there, Pam, but...
I wonder if we're kind of... I've still got Rachel Water coming in this area, but we have crossed into an area that Pam Gossall was trying to cover. So I wonder if we could bring Pam in, and then we'll go to here back, and then we'll go to Rachel next, if that's okay. Pam Gossall.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, panel, and thank you for all your information you've provided so far. My question goes on from what Pam's just asked. In oral evidence, the Scottish Women's Budget Group said that focus on gender equality was important, alongside a participative approach to identify areas for preventative spend or policy. The Scottish Women's Convention noted that improving rights through gender budgeting would improve other aspects of human rights, i.e. child poverty. Do you feel that the budget meets the gender budgeting standards? And could you provide details as to why or why not? And this is probably for Angela here.
Thank you very much. I think I probably started to drift into that sort of territory around gendered analysis and how differences in experience are masked by an equalities mainstreaming approach. Because one size does not fit all, absolutely. And gender budgeting is about feminist policy change. It's about taking a transformative view of the world and taking a transformative approach to policy making that understands structural discrimination and the structural discrimination that arises from gendered social norms that are reinforced in the labour market, in the family, in social security, and in ongoing sexual violence, sexual harassment, and discrimination on pregnancy, maternity, and family related circumstances. So, gender budgeting is about accountability, it's about awareness raising, and it's about ultimately securing changes in government policy from the perspective of informed, quality, robust data, intersectional gender data, being applied throughout. And for that to happen, we need to understand the budget as part of the policy process. It's not separate from, if we set the budget aside from public policy and see policy decisions as something different, then we're missing a big part of the puzzle, a big part of the process. For me, gender budget analysis activates gender mainstreaming because it brings in those concepts of continuous review, bringing in the analysis and the data that we've been talking about, all through identifying problems, identifying policy, potential policy responses, looking at what are the outcomes that policy interventions and associated spend are trying to achieve. So being able to answer the questions through scrutinising what is it we want to do, how will we know if we're doing it, how do we know when we've got there, and what outcomes have we achieved and are they the right ones? And that takes us back in also to the budget review process from 2016-17 and that whole the introduction of the whole pre-budget scrutiny to try, as other colleagues have said today, to try to diffuse some of the party politics around budget scrutiny, but for parliamentarians to look forward and back. So to look back at, have spending allocations and policy objectives aligned? Are they achieving the kinds of outcomes we want to see? And how might budgets be realigned? But for the lived experiences and the different lived experiences of people to be visible. Over many, many years, we've been trying to do this in Scotland. And for many years, finance officials here and internationally have said, what's gender got to do with the budget? The budget's about numbers. Budgets are about people. And people in all the diversity of their experiences and of the discriminatory experiences that they live through as a consequence of these multiple discriminations. And finally, I mentioned in my introductory remarks that the National Advisory Council on Women and Girls has recommended a statutory footing for intersectional gender budget analysis. And my view is that the forthcoming Human Rights Incorporation Bill, combining the Convention for Elimination of Discrimination Against Women
and the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights is a really key opportunity to make that happen. And so there's a role for civil society in scrutinising, and there's very clearly a role for Parliament to be scrutinising that as well.
Thank you for that information, Angela. But just going back to the actual question, it's good to have all that context around the question. Did you feel that the budget met the gender budgeting standard?
Oh, sorry, I thought I was quite clear. No, I don't.
No, right.
We've been trying to do this for 20 years. Yeah, we've been trying to do this for 20 years, and the equalities mainstreaming approach is one which undermines that. And it's not a politics of equivalence where we should look at gender and then we look at race and then we look at disability. We need to look at them in the round, and that needs much more effective resourcing of training to build the knowledge about how to apply. But it also needs a change in our collective thinking, that this is, we're talking about a change in ways of thinking and doing. Policy seems to be made from a kind of generalised analysis of the problem, and then we look to assess through all the kinds of tools that colleagues have talked about today, gender impact analysis, equality impact analysis, human rights analysis. There's a kind of retrofitting goes on there to see, these are the policy decisions that we're taking. How do they fit with our obligations? How do they fit with our objectives around gender equality, race equality, whatever, rather than starting with a better understanding of what's the problem, what's it represented to be, so can we unpick it and understand it better, and then have better, much more gendered policy making as a consequence.
Thank you, Angela. Just a wee supplementary just on that. In a previous session, Susan McKellar spoke about the Scottish Women's Convention being involved in the budget talks with the Finance Minister. She revealed that the women's organisations has asked to be involved in more depth, and we're told no because of the time constraints and around the budget timetable. Are you satisfied that women were heard and included in the budget setting process? So obviously, I know you've talked about the gender stuff, but do you think women were actually heard through the budget setting process?
I think there's a huge area of participation that needs to be addressed. You know, we have one of the most open budget processes in the world, but it's hidden in plain sight, and I have said that many times to this committee and others. And so there is a responsibility for Parliament and for government to be more inclusive and much more proactive about who's involved, how consultative, how inclusive it is. But that goes back to what I said earlier on about participation, and for participation to be meaningful, there needs to be a better understanding, but there also needs to be a lot more proactive effort to engage, not just in formal consultation processes, but in a combination of knowledge building and information sharing that also then incorporates feedback from a lived experience perspective, which can only improve budget setting and other policy mechanisms. So have women been heard on the budget? No. But who is heard on the budget? So, there, as I say, there's a role for Parliament and there's a role for government and for public organisations as well. Local authorities running online consultations on what community members think should be cut from budgets is not informed consultation or participation. So there's a role right across for collective action on that area.
Thank you very much, Angela. I don't know, Chair, does anybody else want to come in?
There's lots of other folk coming in, if that's okay.
That's fine. No, thank you, Angela.
I'm going to have to move on a little bit. Rachel's been trying to get in for a little while, and I think the last area, really. But
it's just going right back to a couple of answers from Claire Gallagher. I just wondered how you believed that the Scottish Government could achieve a better understanding of the link between the evidence that suggests a cut in Scottish Government funding to third sector organisations impacts outcomes such as the example that you gave, which was the gender pay gap.
I think that was for Claire.
Thank you. I think the Scottish Government could improve their understanding and evidence. I think I talked a lot more about the
about data, and I think there needs to be a lot more cross-cutting across all directorates and public bodies around, one, initially capacity building about the importance of data. I think a lot of people see it as I'm just doing it for judgment and not that like it's going to be actionable or anything out of that, and that's certainly something that we've came across in our work. I think in terms of
on that point,
what could be improved. So yeah,
the point that you made was about the budget. Now the intersectional data that you're talking about, are you hoping that that would include the financial link between a budget and an outcome?
Yeah, I think it links into what was just discussed there. I think we need to remember that the outcomes and the what we're talking about when we're talking about outcomes and budget decisions, we're talking about things that affect people and people's lives. So there should be an intersectional part of that. We talk about intersectionality all the time in committees and in public body, everywhere we talk about it, but I think we need to go back and think, what are we talking about when we're talking about intersectionality? And I think we need to improve that across the whole board, because without that, we'll end up like silo different committees. I think intersectional should have a focus on disability as the underpinning protected characteristic. Another committee might think it's gender, and I would always advocate that it's the human rights part. It's talking about the human rights that it impacts, and then we can assess. We use that as our baseline, and that can be a starting point.
I'm going to jump a little bit to Fulton McGregor, just to make sure everybody's getting time to come in. We're approaching the kind of limit of everyone's availability. So, Fulton.
Thanks to the panel. You've already covered quite a bit, so I've only got a short question. I wanted to ask a wee bit about the emergency budget review, and I know some of you have touched on this a bit, but I wanted to ask if you feel that any equalities and human rights concerns have arisen specifically out of the emergency budget review, and how you think the budget might have addressed these concerns. I've not got a particular preference for order, convener, but if you want me to say, I would maybe go Alison first.
Okay.
Thanks for the question. I think there's no doubt that the emergency budget review had to make some very difficult decisions, and ultimately there weren't going to be many winners in this situation. For me, though, the concerns are raised in relation to process. So for all of the focus today on progress around transparency and participation and accountability, I think that was notably absent in the emergency budget review. There was a lack of evidence as to how the decisions were reached that they took, and without knowing what lay behind those decisions, we have no way of knowing whether there was a considered opinion as to, or the choices that were made, whether they had an impact on human rights and equalities, or not being very eloquent. I think, taking an example, around the prioritising of wage increases over spending on employability, that was discussed in pre-budget scrutiny by one of the other committees, that in order to assess that, from my perspective, to ensure that it's not a retrogressive step, because neither choice, neither cut was ideal, I'd want to know, when do they envisage employability spending being reinstated? Who's going to be affected by it? The cut in one hand and the wage enhancement on the other, who benefits most from the different types of spend? Is it, when we look at women, parents, lone parents, people with disabilities, there are considerations there that may well have been taken, but it wasn't apparent in the documenting of the decision making. So in terms of, employability cuts, I think, are a good example of a time when there was a real sudden reconfiguration of our labour market coming out of lockdown, and now today, with the economic instability that we're facing, for employment programmes to have been in the firing line at that point didn't really chime with issues around economic recovery plans or the National Strategy for Economic Transformation for me. The budget document we have in front of us notes that 1.8 million adults in Scotland of working age do not earn enough money to pay tax. And that shouts out that we are a really low-paid economy and people are in need of employability support. So cutting employability to me didn't make sense at that time. So these are the kind of discussions that I think were missing for me from the evidence around the decisions that were made in the emergency budget. Thanks.
That's really useful.
Yeah, Angela.
I hadn't heard that you wanted me to come in there. Sorry, I'm not sure I can improve on what Ali has said. Many of the comments are what I would have said, and it is the read across. And I mean, I said earlier on, in some ways it was, well, I can't say we were lucky. It was. It was a stressful time, and there was a possibility that an equalities analysis of the EBR would not go ahead, given the resourcing capacity within government. And that's again indicative of the need to further embed this whole approach, and that it becomes, it's not, you know, an equality and human rights approach to the budget is not a parallel process. It needs to be absolutely integral to the budget, to budget formulation. And I think, you know, I wasn't clear if your question was about process or about specific decisions. I suppose on process and presentation, again, as Ali has said, there needs to be, you know, greater consistency in the portfolios between allocation, greater flow. I mean, again, in terms of accessibility, there were some improvements could be made in terms of the connection between some of the narrative and some of the graphics around the portfolio. And maintaining the narrative and the links to specific human rights and throughout, and as we've said earlier, showing the alignment between proposed actions and allocation in relation to the National Performance Framework and the recommendations, of which there are multiple from different advisory groups and parliamentary inquiries. So there's an awful lot to juggle and condense in terms of the presentation. In terms of policy decisions and decision making, it goes back to a long-standing, I think, narrative which colleagues have covered very eloquently today in relation to the alignment between policy problems as they are understood and evidenced, the actions taken, and how and the appropriateness of those actions, the extent to which they're properly informed, and how are they then evaluated in relation to the outcomes. Is what was intended being achieved? Is the money being allocated in a way that was intended and having the desired outcomes? And that's what we need to get better at finding out, and what we need to get better at articulating. And the finding out is partly parliamentary scrutiny and greater, you know, wider scrutiny, and it's partly better processes in government.
Thanks very much, Angela. Angela, I know you've got a hard deadline. That was why I pulled you in, perhaps unexpectedly, into that to answer that question before you have to go. Huge thank you, and we'll let you go off to your other meeting before we move to further folk to answer this question. But thanks for taking the time and giving us extra time there. If we could now move to Rob, please.
Thanks, John. First thing to say on the emergency budget review is don't be surprised if there's another one this year. We have an emergency review because of the impact of high inflation eroding the value of the budget, and particularly consequences for public sector pay, and needing to balance the budget, and without being able to change tax rates in year, the inevitable consequence was that spending would need to be reprofiled. And I would stress the word emergency budget review. I don't think anyone would accept that it's an ideal situation to be in, because the risk is that once you're that kind of that long through the year, the areas where you can reprofile spending are narrowed because you've already legally committed to spending lots of money, and that means that there's a risk that basically whatever is easiest to salami slice gets cut, rather than considering the impact of those decisions on wider strategic objectives such as human rights. And it looks like that's why employability was reduced, because it was money that was planned to be spent that wasn't spent at that time. And I was going to make the same point as Ali, but it's just worth stressing that employability is absolutely related to human rights. It's an integral part of the Tackling Child Poverty Action Plan. And when you think about a lot of the users of employability services, many people rely on them to obtain equal access to the labour market, which is also a human right.
Okay, thanks.
And just the last point is that for the what this budget does about that is employability spending is budgeted to increase quite dramatically up to where we expected it to be in this year. But then there's this big question about the government haven't published a public sector pay policy alongside the budget because of the ongoing uncertainty. And so, you know, there's a danger that we end up in this scenario again.
Okay, thanks, Rob. Just to alert our guests that we've got an issue with the chat function, so we can't see if anybody's wanting to come in. So there's a few folks still have maybe questions that they want to ask. If members could, if they have questions, direct it to a specific person, and hopefully we can, a small number. Karen, did you have something further you wanted to come in on?
Just a quick question, if that's okay. Yeah. It was just pulling on from the question of outcomes, and a few of my questions had been answered there in terms of participation and such like, but really one of the key points I think that was raised was that outreach to the public and them informing same way, you know, starting with outcomes and tracing the money backwards. How do we inform and ensure that the outcomes that we're looking at are representative? And I think, Claire, you spoke about how we had a demographic, for example, where a demographic of a particular race that was interlinked with religion, but that wasn't necessarily so. So how can we ensure that the outcomes for that group that aren't interlinked with religion are being met? So what do you think we can do there, really, in terms of improving the feeding of information from the outcomes? Do you think that the Scottish Government can do anything more in that regard? I suppose I'll come to Claire on that.
Thank you. I think just to Claire, when I mentioned before about the race and the religion part, it was a specific portfolio that had put a nationality. They put Pakistan under religion and about efforts around Pakistan schooling for young girls, which is a welcomed commitment within a budget process, but it was just in the wrong section of an impact assessment. So I think for us, what we want to see to improve on that would be a more strategic approach. Those who are in charge of impact assessments, those who are in charge of participation and engagement with the public, their learning and development is paramount on issues that relate to that demographic of people. So we have to make sure that we are up to speed on what anti-racism looks like within participation, what are things that we need to consider in terms of maybe we need a BSL interpreter, what are issues relating to white privilege, what are the barriers that people face to participation. I think those are all, we can't go forward unless we get those things in place, and there's structure there to improve and put those things in place. I think it's just that actionable part, and somebody we've mentioned it before about implementing the implementation gap. That, to me, that's where an implementation gap is in. There's a lot within decisions and the Equality and Fairer Statement about how things are, and there's not a lot about why or what we're going to do about it. And I've said that that is a huge crux in the matter. In terms of for outcomes, I would agree with what has been said by panellists about outcomes, and I think we just need to it's that capacity building around, like, we've got our national performance framework, we've got the programme governance, but I think we've got our budget, but I think we need to increase the awareness and understanding of human rights, and that our outcomes are realisation of human rights, and improve that and realise that human rights aren't political, they are legal obligations, with or without the incorporation bill. The incorporation bill, in my mind, improves accountability and develops that minimum core that we were talking about. But regardless of that, we still have legal obligations, and I think it runs the risk a lot of times that we see that human rights become a political pawn, and that's not going to improve outcomes for our country or for the people in it.
Thank you, Claire. It's really helpful. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thanks to everyone. I think we're going to wrap up there. There was maybe one or two other areas that we might have liked to have covered, but I think we've done pretty well. Thanks to all three of you for staying so much beyond the hour that we'd originally anticipated. It's been a really useful session, lots for us to think about. So the committee will now discuss our next steps in our private session. So that concludes our formal business this morning. We'll move into private to consider other items of our agenda. Thank you.